Even those who have attended my webinar earlier, even for them, it could be useful because I've changed the format. After the initial basic thing, I'll go on to sort of a question answer mode. Whatever I have seen that most of the people, the questions that they ask me or my company or my planners, those are the main questions I will take on. So it'll be more in the less of theory and more of practical things today. Right. So let us start straight away without any delays. I will go on to screen sharing. Okay, right. So I will request everybody not to put on their video because that will affect the bandwidth of other people, everybody, and maybe mine also. Second thing, there's been a problem in my area about electricity since the morning today. So in case power goes off, just wait for 2-3 minutes. We have a generator and it'll come on. So don't have some patience at that time, though I don't expect it to go anymore now. Okay, right. So we start. We start with this webinar as such. As per my calculations, it'll be about 1.5 hours long. Let us see how does it go. Right. So this is me. Lots of people who have registered and they are still joining in. Lots of them already know me. I'm an ex-NDA. I'm June 83 commissioned into the core of EME in Army. I've done my BTech, etc. Financially, I am a SEBI certified registered investment advisor. In fact, I am one of the 7 board members of the National Association of Registered Investment Advisors. I'm also a CFP, certified financial planner, and I am also a member of the 8 member CFP Professional Advisory Council of India. It is the Indian chapter of the US based financial advisory board. Most of you would have already seen me on TV. Primarily, I come in the Money Guru show, but because of pandemic, they're only replaying the older versions right now. I also write in various articles, etc. This was my glory day when I was counted as one of the chosen 14 veterans, along with the likes of Milkha Singh, etc., to be on the Army Day Parade tableau and in Republic Day Parade tableau in 2017. I feel very proud about it. Okay, this is my company. It is a 10-year-old company now, 10-year plus old company. I started it when I took premature retirement from the Indian Army. My company, as the name indicates, is only for armed forces officers and their close relatives. We don't take any civilians as our clients at all. As on today, we cater to about 3,100 plus officers and their families spread all across the world, about 15% from Delhi NCR, 75% from rest of the country, about 10% in almost all major countries in the world. There is no problem because of technology to handle anybody, give advice to anybody, anywhere in the world. We are managing approximately 650 crores of investments as on 31st July. So it might be 75 crores now. And we accept direct stock advisory, which too we are going to come up shortly. Other than that, we deal with everything that is financial planning, retirement planning, all kinds of investments, very good advisory services, filing income tax returns, tax advisory services, loans, insurances, etc. Everything we deal with. And we aim not to be merely a product seller or something like that, which lots of people are. We aim to be your 360 degrees financial planner for you and your family. Again, another proud moment, proud moments over the years when we've been bagging the major national awards. Like in 2019, we got a special jubilee award of UTI CNBC TV18. We were awarded as one of the top 5 financial planning companies in North India, and even the National Stock Exchange counted us as the best financial planning company in North India. Okay. Now, coming to the presentation per se. Some of it would be taken from my previous presentation, but after we have done the basics is where the presentation changes. So when I encounter retired or retiring officers, these are the major questions that are asked to me. How much should I put in bank FD, senior citizen savings scheme, post office MIS scheme? Is insurance a good investment? Should I keep my money safe and avoid stocks, etc.? Should I invest in property? I'm getting a very good property next to my house. It's a small plot and I'm very sure it'll do great. Gold has always gone up in, forever. And should I restart my DSOP on reemployment? You know, these and many more are the basic questions that all officers ask me. I'll try to cover them in this presentation. Suppose I were to ask you, what are your major concerns? And when I ask the officers primarily, what are your major concerns? So these are the concerns that come to me from the officers. Safety of my retirement funds. I want it to be absolutely safe, and very rightly so, because this is your lifetime savings, right? All that you have saved over the years throughout your service is what you have got now or might be getting. How much monthly returns will I get? Will I get some monthly income from my investments? I want money to be invested in such a manner that I can take out all my money whenever I want. So these are the major concerns which are if I were to ask in a priority, this is what is told to me. What do I say? Probably you're asking wrong questions and you've laid down wrong priorities. Why do I say such a thing so dramatically? Because probably, actually, I believe they are not the right concerns. The right concerns are these. Most important, you should be able to meet balance of the requirements and responsibilities of your life for your family. Second, you should be able to maintain a good standard of living for yourself and your family throughout your lifetime. Whether you are 54 right now, or you are 60, or you are 65 or 80, that is the basic requirement. And priority three should be the tactical part. How should you beat the inflation? Your investment should be tax efficient. You should have the money available when you need it. These should be third priority. I'm not saying they are not a priority. In the three priorities, I've definitely kept this part, but these should not be the priority. Priority are these. If you can meet these two things, money has done it, has been purposeful in your life, right? Okay. And when I say, like I said, meeting your life's balance of requirements and responsibilities. What are those? What could be those in your life? These could be marriage of children. Most of the officers have not yet married their children. Own house or its renovation, furnishing. You might be moving into your own house. You might have just bought a house, or you might be having a house which has been on rent for a very long time for you, right? Could be anything. Good domestic vacations. Yes, that is, of course, in pandemic, we can't think of vacations. But it will come. This too shall pass. Then again, normal good life has to resume. So, and in some cases, it could be higher education for children. Somebody might be wanting to take a good car now. Car could be your usual car, repeated, or it could be you might be wanting to go in for higher status car. Could be anything. And then lots of officers, they want to pursue their own passions, whether it is photography or it is traveling the world, or it could be, collecting anything which they want. Changing or buying goods and gadgets. Fauj mein itna sara aapne time nikal liya. Now you want brand new goods for yourself, whether it's your fridge or you want a washing machine or things like that can also be there. Helping a relative. There are lots of officers who want to help some relative, maybe brother's daughter, something like that is always there. And there are plenty of officers who want to contribute on a regular basis to charity. Please remember that it is not that without this lecture, you cannot invest your money. You can definitely invest. The only thing is to home on to the best things, you might take some time if money is not, money management is not something which you've been doing with, you know, aplomb, with a lot of comfort in the past. So you will eventually get it. There is no doubt in it, but it might be that it might take time and you might have missed some of the good years for investing. So with that aim, we go ahead with this lecture. This is what I will be covering. Basic points to keep in mind. These are three important points. Please never ever forget them. Then a question very commonly asked, to commute or not to commute. For those who've already retired or just about to retire, say this month, next month or so, this might not be very relevant question, but for many others, this is the very, very first question that they ask me. One more thing in this, I would like to say, you know, nobody used to ask to commute or not to commute. Nobody even knew that there's something called commutation. Whatever the head clerk has brought the papers, they used to sign it, right? I did a very big mistake. In 2016, I wrote an article exactly with the same name, to commute or not to commute, and then the train started. People wrote additional articles, no, whatever Sanjeev Govila is saying is wrong, or yes, what he's saying is right and all that. And that's where the realization that commutation is an important thing has come into the forge. And this is the first question that everybody asks me. How much safety, how much risk with your lifetime savings should you take? Do you require a monthly income? We'll talk about this. What are the best investment avenues available to you as per your risk profile, your future requirements, and your comfort level? And how to have tax efficient returns? Why is this important? We'll see. How to start for the investments and post-retirement employment? And some very, very important life and income hacks for a great golden retirement. This is how we'll go about it. Three golden nuggets. Don't ever forget them. Number one, inflation. We don't realize inflation is that small bug which eats away at our money, at our investments. Never ever disregard inflation, because that is the one that could become one of the biggest bugbears in our life, right? Here I give an example, right? Say inflation is 7%. Don't look at what is happening today. Today also, actually, the real inflation is 7% only, government data notwithstanding. Why? I'll tell you why. Okay. Say your today's expenditure is 50,000 rupees per month, right? Because of this 7% inflation, your 50,000 per month expenses will be about 1.9 lakhs in 20 years, right? If we look at it from the other side, suppose you have 1 crore rupees, you do nothing, you just put it in a box, right? If you open the box after 20 years, the purchasing power of this 1 crore rupees will be just 23 lakhs because of inflation. Because due to inflation, things have become expensive. We have done nothing with that 1 crore but put it under our mattress or in a box. This is what inflation is, mehngai is. Just see for yourself. I'm very, very sure each one of you would be able to relate to what is written here, right? We all used to buy shoes for 500 rupees just a few years back. Now 3000, very common. 500% increase. You look at anything, school fees, 5,000 rupees is 25,000 rupees now. We used to be happy with a scooter of 50,000 rupees, but now it has to be a car starting from Swift 5 lakhs, right? This is how our requirements have increased. This is how inflation has also added on to it. Now, one secret about inflation. Most of us calculate everything from the inflation data given out by the government. Oh, inflation is 4%. No, inflation is 5%. Actually, that is not the inflation that you and me, we face. The inflation given out by the government is the inflation at basic level. Food, the basic grains, the basic oil, petrol and diesel. These kind of things are what make the basket of inflation on which the government calculates. But you and me, our expenses don't go in that. Our major expenses goes in what we call luxury items, luxury to the rest of the country. There the inflation is minimum 10%. So when you take everything, if I say inflation is actually 7%, even that could be an understatement. So don't look at the data given out by the government. It does not apply to you and me because our expenses are on different items which are not counted in that inflation. Please remember this. So inflation, one golden nugget you have to remember. Second, tax. Never ever forget about tax. You earn something, the government takes away 30% of that as tax. So whatever you've earned is actually what you have earned is 70% of what you've actually earned. Right? So if your investment is such in which directly 30% tax has to be given, then if you earned 100 rupees, you've actually earned 70 rupees only. Don't forget it, because it has a very big bearing on how and where will you invest. See this table. Let's take bank FD, which all of us know. That's the reason I'm taking this. Bank FD is about 5.5%, right? Most of you will be in 30% bracket, right? Actually, you are earning from your bank FD, which is said to be giving you 5.5%, is 5.5% minus 30% of this, which is 3.85%, which is not even 4%, right? And if you are in 20%, even then, no great shake, it is 4.4%. Please remember these things. Wherever there is a direct taxation deducted on your investment, be very careful. Don't put all your money there, right? So some things where taxation is benign, you can definitely look at them, like mutual funds. In debt mutual funds also, if you keep your money for more than 3 years, you get a very concessional tax. In equity mutual funds, you get a concessional tax right from the word go. If you take out your investments, even within 1 year, you just face 15% tax. Of course, the fact remains that taxation is not the only reason you should invest in a particular instrument. Okay. Now, if we combine tax and inflation, what happens? You know, these are the basic slides. So it might be a repetition for some people, but it is very, very important because most of us look at these slides and then forget after some time. See, when tax and inflation combines, what happens? Let's say in a bank FD, you are getting 5.5% interest. You go to the bank and say, I've got 10 lakh rupees to invest. I want to double it. Bank will calculate and say, okay, sir, we'll give you the interest. And in 13 years, your money will be doubled. Obviously at 5.5%, it will get doubled. Now, let's say the inflation too is 5.5. The last data said that inflation is 6.09%. Our inflation is actually 7% and more. But still, let us take inflation also to be 5.5% only. And your tax is still benign at 20%. What will happen? After 13 years, you will get 20 lakhs. There's no doubt in it. Right? However, because the inflation is the same as your rate of interest, the 20 lakh rupees that you will get after 13 years will have the very same purchasing power as 10 lakhs of today. How much has your money actually increased? Zero. 13 years later, 20 lakhs is equal to 10 lakhs of today. So your money in actual buying power has not increased anything at all, right? And on top of that, tax box comes in. What does tax box do? Tax at 20%. This 10 lakhs of interest that you've earned will attract a tax of 2,06,000 rupees. So your net increase in money is zero. On top of that, you are giving 2 lakh rupees tax. And if you're in 30% bracket, 3 lakhs rupees as tax. So just calculate for yourself, have you gained or lost big time? Please remember it. It does not mean you should not invest you should not put your money in bank FD at all. I'm not saying that. But if you put, take your 1 crore rupees or 1.5 crore rupees or 2 crores and put it in bank FD, this is what you will face. Bank FDs would be ideal for emergency money. Money that you think you could require in an emergency. Please remember, emergency money is not 20 lakhs or 10 lakhs. Most of us are very, very comfortable with an emergency money of, let's say, about 5 lakhs. Okay. And the third and the last important point is, how do you evaluate an investment? All of us will remember SLR. OGs will never forget SLR. Right. Every time you have to evaluate an investment on all these three parameters: safety, liquidity, returns. Why am I taking this particular investment? Which of my need does it fulfill? Safety. I am putting my money in bank FD because it provides good safety. Also, it provides good liquidity. If I need the money, I can take it out anytime. That's why I said it is for emergency fund. But does it give me returns? No, poor returns. Let us look at real estate. Does it provide safety? May not, depending on where it is. It could be extremely unsafe, or if it is in a gated colony, or if it is, you know, government allotted plots and all, it could be safe. Liquidity, extremely poor. So I can't say, okay, I'm buying real estate today because I have to marry off my daughter next year. Will not work, not at all. And returns depends. Returns could be blockbuster. If you've been able to grab a good, distress sale property or something like that, or you've been allotted through government quota or at highly concessional rates, it could give you great returns, but otherwise may not give you any returns the way real estate has been in the past 7 years. In fact, it has gone down only since 2013. It has gone down in value. You know, I'll tell you in one instance, personal thing. I stay in Dwarka, right? Dwarka, New Delhi. In August 2014, I bought a flat. And after everything, it cost me 1.55 crores, right? Last year, because of certain requirement, we had to move from that 3 BHK to a 4 BHK flat. I have been trying to sell that flat, that previous flat, for the past 6 months at 1.5 crores. No, it's not selling. So 6 years later, I can't sell it at the same rate at which I bought in 2014. Now, definitely I have to come down by 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs more to be able to really sell it. This is what real estate right now is. Pandemic has made it a bit worse. In the short term, you might see real estate going up a bit because last 5 months demand is pending and now people are coming out to buy, but it does not mean it's a long lasting curve. Remember that. Okay. Now we come on to the questions most commonly asked: to commute or not to commute. And why have I put this skull here? Because this is the very first question everybody thinks. And when they have got the answer to this question, they feel their investment is done. No, it is not so. It is not a do or die question. Should you commute or should you not commute? Or if you've already taken a decision, have you taken the right decision or not? Let's see. What are the important parameters to decide? What should you commute? How much should you commute? Or should you commute at all or not? This is what is the word that keeps going around. Oh, don't commute. Government gives you 9 years worth and takes away 15 years worth. So you are a loser. Okay. Rate of interest in commutation table is so high. I'm sure each one of you would be familiar with this word, commutation table. This is a table which decides how much commutation amount will you get, right? There's a commutation factor which is given in this commutation table in a very, very prehistoric manner, right? There's no calculator. Sorry to see that commutation table a factor being worked out in that manner. And that too has been taken from LIC. Nobody in the government has worked it out. Okay. And people say, you know, whatever pension that you are losing, that the government is taking away from you, then if you invest the extra pension that you get because of not commuting and you invest it properly, you will make more money. You know, these are the words that are going around as far as commutation is concerned. Now, let me tell you something else, totally different. The most important factor that should guide you in your commutation is, what is your requirement, right? Say somebody is able to convince you not to commute. You get less of bulk. As on today, if a colonel retires in the army and if he commutes 50%, he gets about 55 lakhs plus or minus 55 lakhs extra, right? If he does not commute, he gets about 55 to 60,000 rupees per month of pension extra. These are the working parameters. They, of course, some thousand up and down is not what I'm you know, discussing. These are the broad parameters. So what you have to decide is, what is coming up for you? There are lots of officers who retire with huge liabilities, right? They may have, their children could still be studying, even in lower classes. I know of an officer who, when he retired, his son was in fourth class and his daughter was in seventh class because of very, very late marriage, right? So there are so many big things coming up. Should you not commute and leave that bulk requirement and live a Raja's life on a monthly basis, but be fall short of meeting your family's requirement? No, it should not be so. We have to strike a balance. Please remember, commutation is not 0 or 50. You can commute any amount, any percentage that you like. That it could be 0, it could be 10, it could be 5, it could be 20, 25, 30, 35, anything could be there, right? But when you commute it, it is commuted for fixed 15 years. That parameter doesn't change, percentage can be changed. So it should be guided more by your requirements. Suppose you are the kind who has lots of requirements coming up for bulk, then please commute. If you are the person who wants to live a good life, you don't have any big requirements coming up in future, you have basically been able to, you know, meet up all your requirements, major requirements, then you may not commute. Then have good monthly income and try and spend. Spending also. My own experience says that if there is a husband and wife, a couple, living in their own house, even in a comparatively costlier city like Delhi NCR, a monthly pension of about 60 to 70,000 is generally more than adequate for most of the people. Of course, upar ki koi limit nahi hai. You can spend as much as you want, but I'm going by the lifestyle of most of the Fauji officers, right? The third category could be that, you know, you have chota mota requirements, thoda bahut hai, thoda bahut nahi hai. So you could take a call and say, okay, I'll commute, let's say 25% or 20% or 30%, something like that. So that you get some bulk amount and your pension is also not cut down by 50%. So that is how this is the main thing which should guide whether you should commute or not. And don't commute just because somebody has written it in WhatsApp, you should commute or not commute, or just because your own course mate or friend or somebody has commuted or not commuted, right? Other things which I've written here as folklore. See, I'll give you a different perspective of what is commutation. What happens in commutation is, you are basically taking a big loan from the government, right? And the loan is equal to a part of your next 15 years or 180 months pension. A part is decided by you, whether it is 10% or 50% or whatever, right? And the government takes the EMI from you on a monthly basis by deducting that much amount from your pension. That is basically what commutation is, right? For this purpose, the government charges you 7.3% interest. Is it a very high interest? It is not. But it becomes a very low interest. Why? Because had you not commuted, your pension would be fully taxable. Since you have commuted, the bulk that you are getting is fully non-taxable. Hence, the effective rate of interest that you pay is 7.3% less the 30% tax which you would have paid had you been taking the pension. So it just comes to about 5.1% rate of interest on your commutation, right? Are you comfortable with it? Yes, go ahead. If you're not comfortable with this 5.1% interest, which is the real interest that you're paying, don't commute, simple. Okay. Then some people say, if you invest this extra pension, you will get more money. Fogies are never so money prudent. You know, thoda sa paisa bacha and invest immediately. We are so very careful and we are so money prudent that we go and invest it. Never done it all our life. We are never so money savvy. You know, this reminds me of a very popular joke, you know, that a girl is telling a boy that, you know, all these cigarettes that you smoked all your life, had you not spent that money and saved it, you would have been able to buy a Ferrari. So the boy asked the girl, do you smoke? No, I've never smoked in my life. Then where's your Ferrari? So, you know, calculations, Excel sheets, calculators, they can all calculate how much, you know, how much had you saved that money, how much would it have turned into. But we don't work. We are humans. We don't work in the manner of a computer. Okay. Another thing is, suppose something happens to you and the commutation part is still being paid back to the government, then the government takes it as a welfare measure and they do not claim back the committed amount that has been given to you. In effect, it is a welfare measure wherein whatever commutation has been given, usko chhod diya jata hai, it is given away as a welfare portion. So something happens to you, your family does not have to return back that committed amount. Suppose you have commuted, you have not commuted, or you commuted 10% and you feel you should have commuted 20% or 40% or 50%. Within 1 year of your retirement, you can go ahead and commute more, right? But other way is not possible. Suppose you commuted more and you want to reduce it, that is not possible. This is just as a matter of, you know, information that I'm telling you this. Okay. Second question is, how much safety should you take? How much risk should you take with your money, right? Okay. For this, I'll show you this graph. Please remember it. Please try and understand it completely. Let's say this is a scale. One end is high risk investment. Other end is high safety investment, right? And this is your slider. Now you have to decide to go this side or this side. Now, always remember, anything which is high risk does not mean high returns. It only means there's a possibility of high returns. If there was a surety of high returns, then it will not be high risk, no? Then where is the risk if there's a surety of high returns? So high risk means possibility of high returns. You put money in stock markets, if you put it in good stocks, it's likely to give you good returns, may not give you good returns, right? Okay. High safety definitely means low returns. There is no instrument in the whole world. And let me tell you, I know about most of the investment avenues available all across the world, right? Whether it is what happens in US or in Sweden or in Singapore, I am fully aware of such kind of instruments. There is no instrument in the world which is high safety, high returns. Doesn't exist. High safety will always be at low returns. You see around yourself. Post office products, high safety, low returns. Bank FDs, high safety, low returns. Equity, high risk, possibility of high returns. You know, it's always like that. So if you want high returns, you will have to take high risks and move away from safety. Now, suppose this slider, you want to take high returns and you go towards this end. So what are you doing? You're moving away from safety by moving your slider here. And if you want safety, you bring your slider here, then you are moving away from returns. There is no other way that any investment instrument can work. Now, coming to high risk, what are the high risk kind of investments available in the country? Direct equity, you go and buy stocks in the market. Equity mutual funds, they are also high risk because ultimately mutual funds through an investment manager, they also buy stocks. Real estate for investments is definitely high risk. You have to take a risk and you all know about it. Most of you have dealt with real estate. Gold for investment, why do I say that gold for investment is high risk? I'll show you gold's graph. If I don't tell you it is gold's graph, you will feel that it is the graph of some equity stock or of the stock market. So gold is also high risk. When the world is doomed, gold zooms. 23rd March, when the pandemic happened and the equity markets went down, gold went up. Now when the markets are going up, gold doesn't know where to go. It is slowly sliding down, right? And P2P lending, these are platforms which take your money and lend to the needy small investors. The returns could be something like 12% or something like that. But then there is a risk that it is being lent to people who have very less means to themselves. On the other side, when we come to high safety, debt mutual funds, post office products like senior citizen savings scheme, post office MI scheme, post office have FDs also, bank FDs, corporate FDs of good companies, corporate FDs of bad companies or small companies are high risk, definitely. There are perpetual bonds of PSU banks available, which can get you some 8% or so. So SBI, Bank of Baroda, things like that. And then there are debentures available of good companies. They are also fairly safe. In between these two, that means high risk and high returns, is a category called asset allocation products. For example, Reserve Bank of India has launched a floating rate savings bonds, whose rate of interest right now is 7.15%. But if interest rates go down, it will go down, right? Dynamic asset allocation funds, there are kinds of mutual funds which invest in stocks and in these kind of products, right? And depending on when the markets are up, then they reduce the equity. When the markets are down, they increase the equity. That is why they are called dynamic asset allocation. They keep varying as per the markets. So they are the ones who try to play the role between these two at this place somewhere, right? So they are very good products. So dynamic asset allocation products, mutual funds, and RBI's floating rate savings bond. Okay, other products, how good, how bad? When officers come to us, they straight away want us to hit onto what is good investment and what is bad investment. So even in my webinar now, I've changed the format. Please remember, products which should never be taken by any retired officer. An insurance policy, unless you require it. And let me tell you, my own experience and as an armed forces officer and as a financial planner who's been managing this company and 3,100 plus families for the past 10 years, most of the officers do not require any insurance policy. If an agent comes to you and tells you that this is a great policy giving you great returns and all, should be just shown the door because you don't require it. If you take an insurance policy, you will neither get a good insurance nor will you get a good return. Please remember it. The only case could be that you have some peculiar requirements in your life because of which after retirement, the 10 lakh insurance that is available to you from the forces is not sufficient for you. Of course, I'm talking about superannuating officers. I'm not talking about PMR officers who are leaving at younger age. If they're leaving at younger age, definitely they require insurance. And if they require that insurance, it should be only term insurance plan, nothing else. Please remember it. Second product, which most of you should not take, is portfolio management scheme, PMS. Now, these are the PMSs which are very, very heavily 100% into equities, into stock markets. They take a very concentrated exposure of the stock market by taking some 15 to 20 stocks, their own conviction, but our money. Minimum investment that can be done in this is 50 lakh rupees. I don't think any officer should ever go into a PMS with 50 lakh rupees of his retirement corpus. It is not that they might show you very, very good returns given in the past and all that, but please remember that anything which is too good to be true, which seems to be too good to be true, may actually not be true. Remember one thing about data. You can squeeze data in a manner suitable to you to convey anything, right? So I can show you data of the most favorable years to convince you that this bad product is a great one. Okay. Structured products. What are structured products? They're very, very complicated products. If you do this, market will go like this, then this will happen. If it doesn't happen like this, then it will happen. Then in any case, you'll be a winner and all that. That is how structured products work. They have only one aim: to bring you a new dish, new wine in old bottle. Most probably explain it to you in a manner you don't understand. Even if you understand how the maths is working, you don't understand how the product is working, right? I have never ever seen anybody benefiting in the long term with these structured products. In 1 year they may. Suppose their game plays out well and it gives good returns, could happen. Otherwise, most of the people have lost their money. Most these international banks, Citibank, DBS, Standard Chartered banks, these are the banks who are most active in this. But even private banks, some of the private banks who come to you saying you are a favored customer or our best customer and things like that, they try and sell you these structured products. Don't take them. Lastly, anything which you don't fully understand, please never ever take such a product. This is not the time. This corpus, your entire lifetime saving, is not the kind of money you should be using to, you know, experiment. Experiment days are over. You should be putting in things which you understand and which you are confident about. Some things which you should definitely take: home insurance. Most of us forget about it. Our most precious, biggest investment remains uncovered. We are ready to take a bike insurance of a 60,000, 1 lakh bike, but our 1 crore, 2 crore house, we don't take a insurance. You'll be surprised, you can take a home insurance for 10 years, next 10 years, for as low as 30,000 rupees for 10 years, 40,000 rupees for 10 years. Please take it. Don't take a chance. Vehicle insurance, most of us understand, but sometimes because of inertia, we leave it, we don't renew it. And when an accident happens, that is the time we suffer badly. Critical illness and disability insurance, to be taken definitely by people who have a history, of critical illnesses happening in life, in their family. You take it. The insurance premiums are very low. Disability insurance, anybody can have any kind of disability. So in case your disability is going to affect the earnings of your family, please do take it. In case of some people, just 1 minute. Sorry. In case of some people, even medical insurance may be required. Say you are going to get ECHS facility, but it is inadequate or too far or something, you may require to take medical insurance. But don't take medical insurance just because you feel that you should be treated in a 5-star hospital. The truth is quite different from that. There's a long story I can say on these kind of medical insurances, but suffice it to say in this webinar that take a medical insurance only if you really need it, because the ECHS facilities are inadequate in your area. Okay. Another question that I constantly face. Should I take monthly income? Should my investments give me monthly income? Should I continue my SIPs which are going on? Sorry. What should I do with home loan? Let's see. Monthly income. The first question you should ask yourself, why? Just because you got money, just because you can invest it, does not mean you should take a monthly income from it. Let's say your investment has earned 100 rupees. If you take out 100 rupees or 50 rupees out of it, it is not available to you for future future increments. Which means, suppose you put 1 lakh rupees. It's given you 6% returns. So next year it becomes 1,06,000 rupees. If you take out 6,000 rupees from it, then again 1 lakh rupees is available for reinvestment. If you don't really require the money and you let 6,000 rupees also be there itself, then it is 1,06,000 rupees which is reinvested and will earn more interest. This process is called compounding. So please remember, you should compound your money. Unless you feel that your pension is insufficient, you feel that your expenses are more, or you feel I have sufficient money, I don't really need to compound. Or if you say that I don't need any bulk money in future, if I have got grand travel plans, they will all come from within the money that I already have. Then it is all right, you can take out. Otherwise, don't take out money, monthly income from your investments if you don't really need it, which is the case with most of the people. Now, some people, why they say that I require monthly income? Because somehow, due to some notions, they feel that when they retire, their expenses will shoot up. It doesn't happen. There are so many expenses which will go down when you retire. And there are few expenses which will come in, which will never dare. But ultimately, I have found that these pluses and minuses work out in such a manner that the expenses remain almost on the same lines as your pre-retirement expenses. Unless, of course, you have a huge loan to pay or your children, their education is going on because of which a large amount is required on a monthly basis, that is different. Otherwise, just for your living, for your good standard of living, whatever you are spending, you were spending pre-retirement, will remain almost the same. Suddenly, it will not happen that just because you've retired, you'll start eating in five-star restaurants, or instead of economy class, you'll start flying business class. It will not happen. By the time we retire, we are stabilized in life. Our expenses have stabilized. Suddenly we cannot increase it, right? I've had so many cases, officers retire and come and say, oh, I can't do in less than, 1.5 lakhs. I try and reason, they don't agree. After some time, I quietly see, their SIPs coming in because they really can't spend 1.5 or 1.25 or even 1 lakh a month. Very difficult on a sustained basis, right? SIPs. Suppose you have mutual funds and you have SIP systematic investment plans going on right now. In most cases, to my mind, unless you've taken up re-employment because of which your earlier income comes back, or you've gone to corporate and you are earning good money, unless you are doing that, if you're fully retired and not doing anything or not going to do anything, obviously you should stop your SIPs, right? Unless, of course, you've not commuted and now you realize that you're not spending so much, you've not commuted, so you're getting after tax about 1.15 lakhs and your expenses are 60, 65,000 or 70,000. So every month you have this surplus, then of course you can go in for SIPs. Last point in this is home loan. Should you continue with the home loan? This is a very important decision, right? Why? On one hand, if you prepay a home loan, it is possible that a big part of your retirement money will go away. I have seen officers retiring with up to 85 lakhs of home loan. Right? This is a very large amount. And because it is a very large amount, even the EMI per month is large. Right? So you have a very large amount and you are uncomfortable. Your wife is uncomfortable with that at the time of retirement. Of after retirement also, you have such a big amount of loan, right? That is one. On the other side, so if you prepay this, you will barely have anything left of your so-called retirement corpus. On the other side, if you don't repay, then you can't afford that EMI. So what do you do? Suppose you have a comfortable loan of, let's say, 10 lakh, 15 lakh, 20 lakh, even 25 lakhs. You could go midway, right? You could go midway means you could part repay something, balance of the bring down your EMIs. You can afford that EMIs, go ahead with it. You'll get a small tax break also, deduction also. So that could be a midway that you could do. Or else, suppose you've not commuted, then you could tell your bank or wherever you've taken a loan from, tell them to increase your EMIs. The additional EMI that you are paying will actually go into prepaying your loan, prepaying your principal part of the loan, and hence ultimately your loan will have a lesser tenure. So you see, there are so many permutations and combinations in this particular case, but I would like to tell you a few basic points about the loan. Number one, all loans are front loaded, which means in about 50% of the loan tenure time, you typically pay about 75% of the interest. So let's say you had taken a loan for 15 years and already 10 years have passed. Then they've already taken away most of the total interest that you had to pay over those 15 years. There is no point in paying back that loan now. But if your loan is just 1 or 2 years old, then there is quite some time for which they will charge huge amount of interest. Then you can seriously look at prepaying your loan, provided you are comfortable with other things, other requirements that are coming up, other big requirements, money requirements, which are coming up in years to come, right? Second thing is that the longer the tenure, the more will be the interest that you will pay. For example, just as a food for thought, suppose you've taken 50 lakh rupees as the loan for a period of 10 years. How much principal will you pay back? Obviously, you will pay back 50 lakhs only plus interest. And if instead of 10 years, this tenure was 15 years, how much principal will you pay back? Obviously, you will pay back 50 lakhs only. So what extra are you paying in those 5 years? You are paying additional interest, right? So the longer the tenure, the more the interest that you pay. And suppose you are able to increase your EMIs, then your tenure will come down. I hope everybody understands this aspect. So whether you should prepay the home loan or not prepay the home loan or part prepay the home loan will entirely depend on your own life's situation. And the last point that I've written here, the psychological effect it has on you and more importantly your wife, right? Ladies get more affected by mere sir pe bahut bada karza hai, retire ho gaye lekin karza hai, those kind of things. Ladies tend to think more about it. That is also one aspect you cannot disregard. Okay, now coming to what are the best investment avenues available for you. Just go through it. Big slide. But these are the things in which most of the officers think of investing. Senior citizen savings scheme. Here I've written the positives. Here I've written the negatives. Right? Most of the officers, I think almost all the officers go ahead and invest in senior citizen savings scheme because it gives highest safety. And for all those who don't know, it has the highest rate of interest of all government schemes. No doubt about it. But there is a 5-year lock-in. Lock-in doesn't mean you cannot take out under any circumstance. But the problem is that if you wish to take out before 5 years, they levy a penalty on the principal part itself. Right? So that is why I have written 5-year lock-in. Low tax deducted returns. You might be getting 7.4% return, but after 30% tax on it, almost 2.1% goes away in 2.2% goes away in tax, and your net return is 5.2%. Please remember this. Whether you need it or not, you will be given a quarterly interest, right? And after 5 years, you will get your inflation deflated principal return back. Interest has already been paid to you, so only 5 lakhs is left. 5 lakhs that you invested today, you will get 5 lakhs 5 years later, whose value will be much less than 5 years. And the maximum that you can the maximum that you can invest is 15 lakhs in this and no more, right? So whether you should do it or not, I don't know. Because officers want to do it, so we tell them to go ahead. But we tell them these are the positives and negatives. I didn't put my money in senior citizen savings schemes when I retired. Post office monthly income scheme, POMIS. Highest safety, definitely. Again, because it is from the post office. But its returns are pretty poor, very poor. And if you deduct the tax from it, then it is nothing, you know, nothing worth its while. That's what I feel. You get a compulsory monthly interest, which you may not need. Maximum you can put is 9 lakhs. Actually, one person can put 4.5 lakhs. So you can put for yourself and your wife 9 lakhs, maybe for your children also if you want, but I don't recommend it at all. So as an investment idea, we don't think POMIS is a good investment idea. To some people who go to the post office staff tells them that whatever interest you are getting, if you put it in a recurring deposit, your returns will increase from 6.6% to 10%. That is all misleading. Please remember, your returns will increase only if the interest is present in your main post office MIS also and your recurring deposit also, which is not possible. What you do is you take out interest from your main scheme and put it in RD. So it can earn interest only at one place. So how are you adding the interest of both the places together to say that you're earning so much? So this is all humbug. RD rate of interest is much lower, because of which when you put it in RD recurring deposit, the monthly income that you get in from POMIS, if you put it in recurring deposit, then your overall return comes down and not goes up like the post office staff will tell you. Okay, bank FDs, again positive, high safety, no doubt, especially if you don't go to these new, you know, small banks. Plenty of them are there. I don't want to name. Stick to big PSU oblique private banks like ICICI, HDFC, Axis, and all that. Don't go to these small banks. Please remember, anything which gives you higher returns, there is always a risk involved. Otherwise, if there was no risk, nobody will give you higher returns. Of course, in bank FDs, we've already seen there's extremely low tax deducted returns which are available. Corporate FDs, fair safety. Why I write the word fair? Because it depends on where are you investing. If you are taking a corporate FD of Tata's or HDFC or LIC Housing Finance or PNB Housing Finance, then of course there is a high safety. But if you go in for, let's say some small company or some real estate company, obviously the safety is lower. There is another positive is there is no limit of amount or tenure as in bank FDs. Higher tax deducted returns than bank FDs. Typically, there is a difference of about 1.5 to 2% that could be available. However, safety is compromised if the company is not chosen carefully by you. Right? Then comes equity mutual funds. The returns are very tax efficient, good for long term, provided you don't see its returns every day or every week or every month. However, there is a stock market risk. There's a lot of volatility which could be there in the stock market, and their equity mutual funds or equity, directly buying the stocks could be risky in the short term. And when I say short or long term, I'm talking at least about 3 years, preferably 5 years. Debt mutual funds, This, I think, should be the main investment avenue for retirement funds. Why? Because there's a large choice. There are 16 types of debt mutual funds. You can choose funds which invest only in bank and public sector unit FDs to those which take very, very high risks also, right? So you can choose whatever you want. They are very, very tax efficient. They could be as safe as you want, as I just now said. Their returns will be better than FD, and still you have a choice to take out your money or invest any amount of money anytime, including taking a monthly pension from them. However, they could be risky if not chosen properly. Government bonds, perpetual bonds, tax-free bonds, highest safety to high safety, like perpetual bonds of banks, could be high safety. Returns could range from 4.5% tax-free, that means on these tax-free bonds, to 8% taxable, up to 8% taxable. Typically in these, because you buy them from the open market, the minimum investment would be 10 lakhs. Tenure depends on what kind of bond have you bought from the market. And there could be low liquidity because in India, the bond markets are not very, very, liquid. Last is life insurance for investment. High safety, definitely. If you've taken from, you know, LIC, ICICI, HDFC, these kind of big firms, small firms, I won't say anything. Insurance cover also you get, but typically the insurance that cover that you get in these investment linked insurance policies is very, very low. However, there is a high agent commission. There are very low returns. Even if the agent is able to tell you that this policy will give you great returns, never ever believe him, because insurance policies are not designed to give any high returns, right? Yeah, somebody is asking somebody to stop the video. Please, please don't put on your videos. It will disturb others. And typically these life insurance policies are hugely missold to the retired or retiring officers. Please be very, very wary. As a principle, which is true in all circumstances, if you have to take insurance, take only term insurance, nothing else. No agent will sell it to you. Why? Because there's hardly any commission in it. They will sell you other products which are absolutely unsuitable. Okay. Now, coming back to the safe avenues, because that is where your investments of retirement corpus should go to. Most of the officers typically focus on these: senior citizen savings scheme, POMIS, bank FDs, insurance, real estate. Insurance, I've told you, real estate, I'm not at all confident of what real estate is going to do in times to come. Please remember, I have nothing against real estate. In fact, we deal with real estate. We deal at project levels. We pick up full projects and market them. I've got experience of marketing projects in Pune and Mumbai and Delhi and Noida and Gurgaon, everywhere. For the past many years, we've not touched real estate because of what I told you at the beginning of the seminar, that real estate is going nowhere. It will go nowhere. Don't look at what is going to happen in next 2, 3, 4 months. It is only the past 5 months pandemic pent up demand which will drive the real estate a bit, but real estate is in real bad shape. Don't enter it for the purpose of investment. Unless, of course, you can find some distressed sale property or something which is at much, much lower levels, lower rates than the market. Don't get into it, at least not with your retirement corpus. And some people also go into PMS and all this, which I have already talked about. Generally, officers miss out on debt mutual funds, which I think should be your mainstay. Corporate FDs of very, very good companies, they'll give you higher returns. You may also take tax-free bonds if you are very, very, very persistent about not paying tax. then tax-free bonds are there. Perpetual bonds of banks like SBI, Bank of Baroda, Punjab National Bank, kind of things, they can give you up to 8% returns even today. There are some limitations of these. So anybody who wants to know, they can interact. And corporate bonds are also there, which can give you good returns. So do not be solely focused on these. These are also, these are great investment avenues, which will help you take care of the two biggest bugbears, that is taxation and inflation. So like I said here, debt mutual funds, there are a lot of people who do not know what mutual funds are. Or alternately, they know what mutual funds are, but somewhere they equate mutual funds to be stock market. It is not so. Mutual funds are of two types, equity and debt. Equity invests in stock market. Debt invests primarily in three things. That is, number one, government bonds. Number two, bank FDs. And number three, corporate FDs. Right? There is no equity components in them at all. There's no stock market component in them. In addition, you can invest any amount that you want. Right? You can invest it in as many tranches as you want. You can take out any amount of money at 4 days notice as you want. And in case you don't take it out and you continue beyond 3 years, your tax could come down by as high as 70%, right? So they could save you huge amount of tax also. Okay, So this is what, and in case at any point of time, let's say you commuted and you start feeling that somehow your expenses are turning out to be higher than what commuted pension that you're getting, then you can go in for something called systematic withdrawal plan, SWP, from your fund, from your mutual fund, whether it is equity fund or debt fund. And you will be surprised to know that your taxation could be just about 15 to 20% of what, let's say, you are paying even on your pension. So extremely tax efficient way of taking additional pension from mutual funds. How it happens, I can explain to anybody who's interested, but it is slightly long story. We had given out a, mail few days back, in which we had written how systematic withdrawal plan suddenly brings down your taxation. Okay, now gold. Gold is what I had mentioned earlier. See, you look at this chart. Does it not look like a stock market chart? And this is silver. This is the state as on September 4th. That means last Friday. This Friday, right? And in case we move out this part, 2000 onwards, whatever has happened, you know, and we compress this chart, you will feel it is the stock market chart you're looking at. And here, do you see this? Do you see now gold starting its downward journey? This is how gold is. I'm quite confident that after some time, gold is again going to go back. But then in the long run, let's say next year by about March, April or so, I expect gold to start its downward journey. So after all this knowledge, how should you start and plan for your life? Right? Please, now, if you are recently retired or about to retire or some time to retire, work on this. What are your regular earnings? What are your regular expenses? Take stock of your existing investments and what are your upcoming expenses, major expenses. We never write it down. We leave it to after retirement, and after retirement, somehow we don't feel like doing it. So we never ever plan. We plan for everything else, but we don't plan for our retirement. Okay, jab retire ho jayenge tab dekhenge. That day doesn't come, right? I will try and show you. This is a dummy plan. These are the kind of plans that we make for people who opt for this this kind of module. So I'll try and show you what are the major things you should take into account while planning, right? See, this is a statement of position as to what all do you have: flat, car, gold, etc. Right now. And what are your disposable assets as on today, right? And more importantly, what are your liabilities? Please write them down, because like they say in Staff College, if it is not on paper, it is not there. Right? This is how our expenses and our pension is going to increase. Pension going to increase, taxation going to increase, expenses going to increase. And hence, what is going to be the annual and monthly surplus? I don't want you to start making charts like this, but please keep this in mind. See how the costs, the pension could increase, but the surplus, the expenses, etc. could increase, right? Then here I've given out what could be the major expenses of people, right? If this is the time in which they are coming up, and this is the current cost, then due to inflation, how much amount could be required? Let's say a marriage of a son requires 25 lakh rupees. Daughters requires 25 lakh rupees. In 2038, that means 18 years from now, this 25 lakhs could be 1.5 crores. This is how costs increase. So you have to work on today's costs as also future cost, and have to make sure that you are able to meet these requirements. Car, you could be changing your car every 8, 10, 12 years, and that cumulative cost itself could be very high. Vacations itself could have very high costs, right? Please be aware of them. This is a very important thing which you should definitely do. What are your assets right now? Something you have in bank, something in mutual funds, etc. These kind of things. And these are your goals or future requirements. Try and do some preliminary mapping of these two things. Then you will know whether you are falling short somewhere. Should you cut down your expenses? Do you need some more allocation to this particular goal? Things like that, right? And here we have just shown how your goals are likely to work. Green one is the one this particular officer will be able to meet. Red one, this officer will not be able to meet the way he is going now. Same way you have insurance policies. They might be lying somewhere in the corner somewhere. Open them, see what they say. Are they suitable for you or not? They could be, like in this particular case, this is a term insurance plan. We've said, please keep it. LIC Jeevan Suraksha, we've said it is junk, please get out of it. You know, same, you could come to the same conclusion when you read the fine print, maybe for the first time in your life, ever since you've taken it. Home loan, again, work it out. How much is going to be your year-wise balance? How much is going to be your EMI? And work, suppose you prepay a bit, how much interest will you save? You know, this needs some working, but you will be able to do it. There are large number of calculators which are available on the net. Of course, you go to a financial planning company like us, we'll be able to do it for you. And then write down what have you discovered, what should you do and what should you not do. This is how planning is done. So it is very important to know, where do you stand today? Where do you need to go to financially? Whatever you are doing right now, is it all right or not? If not, what should you do to be able to reach there? And that will guide you on how should you invest your retirement costs. In spite of all this, what do most of the retired officers do? Do you relate to this? When the inflation itself, if they are putting 1 crore rupees in investment, without taking into account the inflation, without taking into account the taxation, etc., and they put it there, and 1 crore, the effective value of 1 crore after 5 years is 94 lakhs, and after 10 years is 89 lakhs, right? So the real value of the money has actually gone down instead of getting any returns, when we adjust it for inflation, for taxation. Please be wary of that. Please don't get into such kind of a situation. But this is when I am saying that inflation is only 5%, which actually is much more. So what do we recommend for you after all this discussion? This is what AG's branch says. 80-85% of corpus in safe avenues, 15-20 in higher risk avenues that can provide better returns. But please remember that this is not something which is true for everybody. In some cases, it could be 100% here if one is uncomfortable and doesn't need to take any risk. In some cases, this 80-85 could be just about 60-65 also. If there are longer term goals which are coming up and you have to save money, you have to increase your money, available money for that purpose. So this is what we suggest, right? That these are the kind of things that you should do. Actually, I would not like to suggest this also, but because most of the officers, they get influenced by their peers and they say, no, savings, seniors, citizen savings scheme I have to put. So we put it here. Otherwise, I don't think people should put it there because the rate of return is low. And another thing, one very big, funda going around in retirement communities, you should not put your money at all in stocks. Please remember, stocks chosen carefully or good mutual funds chosen carefully are real long-term wealth creators. So if suppose you have to change your third car from now, let's say 20, 25 years later, you should use equity mutual funds for that. Right? Everybody is different. Everybody's life is different. Requirements are different. Comfort levels are different. Expectations from life are different. Hence, whatever I've shown to you, please don't at all go by that at all for yourself. It is just a guideline. Tweak it for yourself. If you find any problem, we are always there. Of course, now here I come and make a differentiation between superannuation and those who are taking premature retirement much earlier in life or are SS officers and retiring, right? So please remember that whatever I've said, basic principle apply, but all the principles may not apply because you really don't have to be to play it so safe because you have a large working life. You can take more risks. You may not have large immediate liabilities and you almost definitely will not require monthly income because if you are taking a premature retirement or if you are a SS officer at young age, then definitely you'll be joining some company, taking up an alternate employment, taking up, going in for something else definitely. So you should take risks as per age and your risk profile, which could be definitely much higher than the retired officers. And you should invest on a monthly basis of your surplus and you should definitely take equity, stock market. In a nutshell, please read through it. If you follow these do's and don'ts, I'm very, very sure that your retired days will truly be the golden years of your life. Provided you don't get into biases, you don't get into hearsays, and you really apply your mind, you really apply what is applicable to you. Don't apply somebody else's solution to your own life. Okay. Other important aspects of life, will. Definitely do make a will. If you don't have a will format, please write to us on contact@humphogy.in. I'll show you that email ID later also. Please write to us. We'll give you a very, very good format, which you can customize as per your requirements and make a will, right? If you have, if any of these are your requirements, trust deed, you want to gift any money, power of attorneys are required, definitely you should do nomination in each and everything that you do. All your bank accounts should be joint accounts with your spouse. everything that you do should have a nomination, whether it is life insurance or mutual funds or any other products that you buy, everything should have nomination. Charity, identify with a cause. Please remember that this is the only thing we leave behind. Nothing else will be worth it. It is what we do good to others is what we actually is our life is. What we earn and what we spend is ephemeric. It doesn't stay, but what we do good to others is what stays in our life and beyond. Taxation aspects. Please don't go wrong on taxation and don't go by what some people are saying. Your complete retirement package, all the five things that are there. That is, number one, your AGIS, NGIS, AFGIS money that you receive. Number two, your gratuity. Number three, your commutation. Number four, your leave encashment. And number five, your DSOP. All the five things that you receive are fully tax-free. When you file your income tax return, say somebody is retiring this month, when you file your income tax next year, return next year, you definitely have to show these in your income tax return, but these will be shown as tax-free. So they come on record, income tax people don't send you a notice, how come you've received 1 crore, 1.5 crore, 2 crore in your bank and not shown it in your ITR and all that. So it is just a single line that you have to mention there. Now, investment of this money. If you invest in tax-free bonds, if you put a part of it in PPF or in insurance policies and that policy is not broken before 5 years, shares oblique equity mutual funds after 1 year, of course, after 1 year, some taxation has come in now, and debt mutual funds after approximately 3 to 4 years, they could be tax-free or it could be a very, very nominal tax there, right? Fully taxable, whatever you do from bank, whatever you do from post office except PPF, that is public provident fund, everything is fully taxable. Your pension, unless you've got any disability pension, then your entire pension is tax-free. Or if you have a gallantry award, not any award, a non-gallantry award doesn't count, but if you have a gallantry award, then your entire pension is tax-free. So the pension is tax-free only in two cases. Disability pension, if you are getting even a single rupee nominally of disability pension, your entire pension is tax-free, right? Other issues, gifts. See, gifts to major children or to close relatives, the gifts are, they don't have to pay a tax on them and it becomes their money. But if you give a gift to your wife, then whatever returns happen on that money is still taxed in your hands. Have no doubts. Lots of officers, in a mistaken belief, they go and invest in mutual funds and some bank FDs, etc., in their wife's name. As long as it doesn't get discovered, great. If it gets discovered, then the whatever interest has been earned will be clubbed with your, along with 500% penalty. Please be wary of this. The income tax rules are very, very clear on this. Okay. Now, this is my website. Why I'm showing you this website is there's a huge amount of relevant things available to you. As I've told you, that we only deal with armed forces officers and their families. So whatever you find on our website, everything is only oriented towards armed forces officers. So if you are retiring, you have questions, there is a huge possibility that most of the answers you will find on our website at this drop-down knowledge, this is the drop-down, or in blogs where I would have written something about it in all probability, right? Then of course, we are very, very, this is my blog where we write on a lot of things and continuously keep writing. And keep adding at least 2 articles per week. This is our Facebook page. We again keep putting up a lot of things there. And this is our Twitter, where again, there are a lot of things which are there, right? Last part is income and life hacks for a golden retirement. Now, I will request each one of you to to listen to it very carefully. The things I'm going to say are the most important things in life after retirement. And this is something which I have learned from my own life, as also from thousands of officers serving and retired that I keep meeting. Easiest way to fritter away your corpus, these things, right? Traditional insurance policies, impulsive buying like a property. Aray, bahut achha plot mil raha hai. Chalo, let's buy it without seeing whether it is going to give you something or not. Keeping large amounts in savings bank account, bank FDs, etc. Investing in stock markets with little or no knowledge. Relying on free advice, nothing ever is free, including our advice. Important aspects pertaining to retired life. Please pay attention to this. See, let us say a colonel is retiring today, 54 years of age. How many more years of active life is to be lived? We take lifetime to be 85 years. Out of that, please leave out last 10 years when the body is not willing, mind is also conditioned, and one does just wants to live more peacefully and not do anything of the hectic life that one has seen. So active life is 70 up to 75 years maximum, which means 15 to 20 years, right? This is the time in which whatever you've not been able to do in life because of any reason, whether it is professional hazards, being on difficult postings or whatever, this is the time that you can do now, right? You have to lay out what kind of life do you want to live from now onwards. Please make a plan for life. I'm not talking about investments only. Sit down with your wife. What do you wish to do? You don't have much time. Another thing, please remember, who will outlive the other? It is a given certainty that out of me and my wife, one of us will go away earlier. Who will go and when will go? I don't know. We have to keep in mind that the spouse who's left behind should not feel that we've not lived a great life together. This is the time to live a great life together. Now, starting now. Please remember that. Please plan for it. Where should you settle down? You should settle down not as per where your children are, not as per where your relatives are, as per where you'll have the best of life. If it is to be with coursemates, if it is to be with friends, in native place, in Himalayas, or in your village, or amongst your children, then be it. But please don't go by what the world does. Your life is unique. You see, which will give you the maximum pleasure of life now. Your children's role in life. Please remember, I'm just repeating what I've written. You are not to be their ATM. And they are not to be your retirement plan. Because the world has changed. Children want to be self-sufficient unless we tell them not to be. That is where the ATM part comes in. And second, children also have their own life. We should let them go away. We should not tag on to them, and they should feel that their life is getting clustered because of our presence. Remember this aspect. Have your own retirement plan, which may or may not include the children. Should you leave a house each for your children or a good lump sum of money? Not necessarily. We have all given the best to our children. We've given them the best of education. We've given them the best of the opportunities. When most of us started, we started from a lower level and we've reached here. Our children started from here. Will they not go more than that? Please remember this. There is no need to give one house to your son and one house to your daughter. Do they need it? Have you asked them? We give them a house in, Gurgaon, but they want to settle down in Mumbai or in Bangalore or in New York or in Sweden. So these houses will become a chain around their knuckles. Better to give them money, than say I'll give you a house which you don't want. Please remember this aspect. What contributes to an enriching retired life? There is something after being out of the army for 10 years I have learned. Physical assets, where your money is locked and there is no accretion to your life. If I have 5 houses, I can only live in one. What do the other four houses do? They cause me tension because their prices are going down. I have to collect the rent. I have to take care of any stupid tenant going away at his whims and fancies and looking for another tenant. There is no accretion to their value. And the rent that I get is just about 1.5% of the capital that I pumped into it. My life's biggest assets earn me 1.5%. What good is that? If I require any money, I can't sell half a bedroom. I can't sell a kitchen. Of course, I can break my bank FD. Of course, I can sell my mutual funds. Of course, I can sell my, surrender my insurance policy. Right? So please move away from physical assets to financial assets where liquidity is available. Please remember, liquidity, availability of money is what will make your life rich, not a lot of assets. My 4 houses, additional houses, will not give me any life, not give me any pleasure in life. But having those 4 crores with me has the potential to give me a lot of pleasure, whether it is going on cruises whenever they open, or to gift to my grandchildren, make them, spoil them, or go with my grandson Disneyland in Hong Kong. So it is the availability of real cash which will make your life worth living from now onwards. Should you create further assets, another house, plot of land, for what? Why should you add more stories? Because more stories in your house which are not occupied by your own family members is more headache for you. Remember this. Moving to a giant house where just the 2 of you are going to live will become a headache after some time. You might have discovered in pandemic that a maid will also not come. Right? Please read this. Live like there's no tomorrow. Because actually, there's no tomorrow. We are only living in today's. How should you handle your money? How much risk should you take? Lifelong savings, but inflation? Assured safety. Wherever you have assured safety, please remember, it is an assured risk of low return. So, think about it. How should you handle your money? What is our take? You need to live a life which is enriching, enjoyable, fulfilling. We have very less time now. Not much time. It is not the time to create more assets, but enjoy what we have created all along so far. This is the time to enjoy. This is the time to have that golden period in our life if you want to. We should let the children fly on their own. We've done our responsibility. We should let them negotiate their own world. And now is the time for us to explore our friends, the world, whatever we wanted to do but couldn't do due to service constraints. Live like rich. I don't have to be rich to live like rich. I have to have that bent of mind to live like rich. Coming to more smaller things in life, do you need an advisor? I, as an advisor, my company as an advisory company, does these things. Our biggest role is in hand-holding, in ensuring that people don't take wrong decisions. People don't take panicky decisions. We transit during this pandemic from March to today. 5 of our investors, senior officers, have passed away. While we cannot do anything with their emotional trauma of the ladies and the families that are left, we definitely tell them, just don't worry. Forget about everything. we need only one document, that is death certificate from you. Give us 15 days and everything we will transit, we will transmit seamlessly in your name. Whether you want the money out or you want to transfer the portfolio in your name, don't worry. This is not the time for you to bother about these things. Take care of yourself. Take care of your family. This is the time. Money part, we'll take care. And we keep doing it. And we have done it for years now. Contrary to popular belief, we work on very thin margins. If I tell you that my margin is 0.4%, not even 1%, 0.4%, you will feel that I'm not telling you the truth, but this is how financial advisors actually work. We work on big, on volumes. So I don't have very much incentive for my more incentive comes from seeing the pleasure in on the faces of our investors when we do things right. Integrity and professional competence of a financial planner and your comfort with that company is the most important thing of a financial planner. I will request you, if you can please give me a feedback, then I'll take the questions. I'm also typing it in here. You can just go to in the chat box. I'm typing the URL. Request you to go there if you like what I have given out. Please give a feedback, and feedback should be more on what we can improve so that next lectures are better. I'll request you to give these feedback on that link so that we can compile it later. Okay. Now, I have finished. Sorry, I have taken 10 minutes more, but probably it was worth it. Now I will, just 1 minute. Anybody who has questions can please start typing it in the chat. There are questions which have been asked earlier, I think. I'll just go through them. Question by Deepak: will be grateful if you could talk of taxation when you do not commute. That is, what is the money we get after contributing to taxation, and how does it then compare with computed lump sum? I have already covered it. So I'll just repeat, because the question is there and you put it while I had not spoken about it. So when you commute, whatever is the commuted bulk that you get in your hand is non-taxable, but the pension that you get is taxable unless you are getting a disability pension or you are a gallantry award winner, then it is not taxable. Right? Somebody, Vipin, has asked for investing in index funds. Index funds are good way to invest in stock market. When you invest in index funds, you are taking the equal exposure to all the stocks which are there in the index in which you are investing. For example, if you are investing in Nifty, then all the 50 companies that are part of the Nifty, they are being invested into. If you are investing in a Sensex based fund, and likewise it is there. Instead of large cap funds, index funds could be a good alternate way to invest. Investing in investment in gold bonds, Vinayak Shrimal has asked. See, gold, now I think gold has already reached big highs, right? If you invest in gold bonds, I take it that you are referring to the sovereign gold bonds. If you invest in the sovereign gold bonds, then you are locked in for 8 years, but minimum 5 years. What will happen to gold in these 5 years? I don't know, because I don't see the moment the world starts recovering, gold prices will come down. So when the gold was down, say about 3-4 months back, we recommended people to invest in sovereign gold bonds, but now we are not recommended people to invest in sovereign gold bonds. Any Vipin has also asked any importance of creating NPS account on superannuation. See, NPS is National Pension Scheme. Please remember, don't invest there only for the sake of getting 50,000 rupees extra tax benefit. 50,000 rupees on a 20% tax bracket is just saving 10,000 rupees of tax per year. But you getting locked in and all that is not a nice way to do it. If you wanted to invest in NPS, one should have done it much earlier, much before superannuation. Now might be a bit late. What is the taxation policy on switching of debt mutual funds from equity to debt to equity or equity to debt? It doesn't matter. Whenever you switch even from one scheme to another scheme, taxation comes in. Right? Now, debt funds, if you have kept a particular debt fund for less than 3 years, then whatever profits you have made there, that will be added to your income as short-term capital gains. In case you've kept it for more than 3 years, then on the gains, indexation will apply. Your effective tax, even if you are in, let's say, 30% tax bracket, your effective tax might come down to some 7, 8, 9%, and that tax has to be paid as long-term capital gains. Anybody else? Any other question? Okay. Captain Vinay Singh, you are retiring at the end of the year. I have given on the slide, on the shared slide right in front of you, our mail ID to contact. That is contactus@humphogy.in or office@humphogy.in. You can send us a mail. Otherwise, two phone numbers are given. These are of my people who are dealing with this part. You can ring up any one of them. Suppose you wish to discuss anything with me, this number 9999022033. That is Bombay, Calcutta. This number is my personal number. I have only one number. You can speak to me in case you wish to discuss something to me. Manoj asks, if there is no requirement to commute, should we commute if reason is only to reduce tax on pension? See, if there is no requirement to commute, that means you do not have any long-term requirements. Fine. But do you have any, what is your monthly expenses? Please remember what I said, your expenses will not increase overnight. The day you retire, your expenses will not be high the next day. No. Your expenses will generally be in the same manner in which you are spending earlier. It is always good to have bulk with you if you don't have requirement for more monthly income. You know, you could go on that around the world in 10 days or things like that, or cruises, or you know, you can do things which you always wanted to do but could not do. So bulk will never hurt you. You can do a lot of charity. You can do good to a lot of people if you have the bulk. So take a call. If you want your monthly income to be slightly higher, instead of 50% commutation, do 25, 30, 35% commutation. So, you know, it is something that it is your call. If you find yourself difficult to be able to take a decision, discuss with me. I'm always open there. Only for the sake of reducing tax, of course, tax is reduced to a great degree, but that should not be the main criteria. Your requirement should be the main criteria. Remember, taxes and death is not something we can avoid. So forget about tax. The more important part is your requirements. Somebody, Captain Vinay, has written, "I missed a major part of your PPT." Please don't worry. We will be converting this. We are recording this, and we will be converting it, and we'll be sending a link around to everybody and definitely to the people who are here in the webinar and have registered. It will come within the next about 4 to 5 days. plan on more tax saving schemes post retirement. Tax saving schemes are very limited. You can go in for the PPF if you want, though it locks you in for next 15 years. Or you can go for equity linked savings schemes, which are equity mutual funds, hence they invest in stock market, but the lock in there is merely 3 years. So these are good tax saving schemes which are available. Why are you placing SCSS? Jayant Sahu says, why are you placing SCSS and other post office schemes as bad investment options? No, Sahu, please don't mistake me. I'm not taking them as putting them as bad investment options. I have shown the positives. They are very safe. Senior citizen savings scheme is the highest interest that you get on any government scheme. My issue there is about three things in senior citizen savings scheme. Number one, post-tax returns, you straight away pay a 20% or 30% tax on whatever you get. So your net returns comes down. The net return of 5.1, 5.2% that you get, if you're comfortable with it, it is a good scheme for you. Number two, whether you need it or not, you definitely get monthly, quarterly income there. See, look at it from a psychological point of view. You have after retirement, you will generally have 3-4 lakh lying in your bank account. Some 27,000-28,000 comes into your bank account every quarter and gets merged. You will not even realize that it is there. But what actually is happening is all the earnings of your senior citizen savings scheme are going to do nothing to your life. Because we are not so financially savvy that we will be so particular and meticulous to invest each and every rupee that comes into our bank account. So that interest does not add anything to our life, right? Third thing is there is a lock-in of 5 years at least. These are the only things which I brought out. If you're comfortable with all these three things, great. It's a great scheme for you. POMIS, post office, other post office schemes, definitely I say they are not good schemes because the returns are very bad and there is lock-in and there is, I mean, all the bad things are there in there. Okay. When should one start planning for retirement? Two parts in planning for retirement. Number one part, planning for what you are going to do after retirement. That should be planned 2 years earlier. 1.5 is the minimum I would say you should start your planning, right? How to do that? I don't know whether I'm competent enough to take that point up and speak on this, but this is something I really want to tell you because I keep guiding one-to-one to people. But as far as retirement corpus is concerned, I think just about 2 months before retirement is more than adequate, maximum 3 months. You don't have to start worrying about it 1 year or 1.5 year in advance because there's nothing that you can plan. Everything will start only when you get the money. So 2-3 months before retirement is more than adequate. How to choose ideal mutual fund? Oh, this is a long topic by itself. So when I do my general webinar, I'll cover that part. Can I get a copy of this recording? Definitely, I've already told you. For serving officers, it is also advisable to invest in pension fund even beyond the scope of saving tax. I don't know which pension fund. There are two NPS. NPS you can look at because they are giving good returns. But you get locked in for a long time. That is very, very big disadvantage of NPS. So people like us, Fojis, who get pension on their own NPS, that is why I try and discourage. But please go on to my blog. There I have written a lot about NPS. Please read it in detail. If it is a mutual fund, pension fund, you can do that because there's no lock-in. There's no lock-in beyond 5 years. So you can do that. They also give good recommend. Why did you not recommend PPF? I did not recommend PPF because PPF, you can only invest 1.5 lakhs maximum per year. So it is not something with which you can do anything with your retirement corpus. But as a tax saving, I really like PPF. So for only for tax saving purpose, you can definitely take on PPF. Maximum investment is 1.5 lakhs there. We have properties, Sumangla Kapoor says, we have properties, but the value has gone down by 20%. We wish to dispose them, but not sure of this step. What's your take? Age is 65, 63 for us. Right, ma'am? If the value has gone down by 20%, don't look at the volume value coming up in a hurry. I rather say that if you are looking at 20 it to come up for by 20%, I think it will take very many years the way real estate right now is. In fact, if you sell it even at current low values and put that money in bank FD, you'll make much more interest on it. The money is available to you to enjoy. The money is available to you to do whatever you wish. So I myself am of the this thing that we should not peg a certain value in our mind. I will not sell it at that and keep waiting for years and losing the notional interest that we otherwise would have earned. This is called opportunity cost. So we are losing a lot of opportunity cost if we don't get out of properties just because their value is not up to a level that we have thought of. It may never come up to that level. That is what my reading of property of years of experience says. You should take, sometimes it's worth it to bite the bullet also. So bite the bullet, take this money. You are 63, 64, 65 years of age. Property will do nothing to your life. Take that money and enjoy. That is the time. Going by what I said earlier, it is the time to enjoy, and it is running out. Okay, there's one private question which has come to me from Sanjeev Sharma. You can cover the time gap for retirement in 10 years, 5 years and 2 years. What to do and how to go forward? I don't think you require that many years of planning. Only for post-retirement avenues, you need about 2 years of planning, preparation and deciding what you wish to do. What percentage of salary to invest in DSOP before retirement? We will have to talk about it because I don't know what are your requirements. I would not want to give out any block figure here because it will differ. After taxation, from Deepak, after taxation commutation is it equivalent to what we get in lump sum, even if it is pay of lesser years? After taxation of commutation, I've not understood the question. I don't know what does that mean. Sanjay, with bank interest rates going down, is commutation still better option with 7.3%? Bank interest rate, see, when you do commutation, you're commuting for 15 years. Don't look at what is there today and tomorrow. For 15 years, we are taking a decision. So don't take a decision based on what is the bank interest rate today. In about 1.5 years time, bank interest rates are going back. So what is 1.5 years in a 15 year time horizon? Right? So this is called recency bias. Don't let recency bias cloud your judgment today. Bhavishya says, don't you think market valuations are very high and investment in equity will not be very effective considering PE ratios? I fully agree with you and more, Bhavishya, that market valuations are very high. That is why when you invest, if you are going to invest in equity markets today, there have to be some filters applied. There has to be a strategy applied in which you invest in markets through SIPs. And if you have bulk amount, you invest in markets through STPs, systematic transfer plan, in a very, very slow manner. Please don't go into the market and put all your, 5, 10, 20, 30 lakhs there, you will suffer because the market valuations are extremely high. As far as me, I am concerned, they are in a red zone. However, the way equity markets have behaved during this pandemic, there is much more to valuations. So there are other forces which are at work, which requires a different webinar by itself. SD Mathur, once we invest in equity or debt mutual funds through you, do we essentially go through you for redeeming, or can we do it ourselves by registering ourselves on registered side of these funds? SD Mathur, please why us? You invest through anybody. The money is yours. The fund is yours. You can disinvest in whatever way you want. You can go to the mutual fund companies yourself. Do it. And any financial advisor worth his salt, and we consider ourselves worth our salt. If you tell us, I want to get out, I want to have nothing to do with it, we will definitely redeem your amount the way you want. Ultimately, it is your money. We are only your managers. So, you know, there's a lot of ethics and values that go into making a good financial advisor and advisory company, right? Can we get a copy of the presentation? All that I've already said. Vijay, I'm starting in MS with earlier now. Can Hamfaji regulate them and get it under one umbrella? Absolutely. We do it all the time. When you come to us, then we go through all your investments. We give you advice on that, our unbiased advice. And first we go through all your investments along with your new investments, and then we go ahead, right? Can we continue PPF account after retirement? Definitely. Mahesh has asked, can we continue PPF accounts after retirement? Definitely. If you already have a PPF account, my strong recommendation is that is the one which should be your tax saving avenue, right? But after retirement, if you open a PPF account, it is 15 years of lock-in. So you have to see whether you are comfortable with that. But please continue your PPF account. Captain Vinay Singh, sir, there has been conversation on stopping disability pension on various forums. What is the extant policy? Can you please elaborate? See, disability pension, some political things, there was a lot of talk of it, but then there was a hue and cry, and the veteran community was very successfully able to take it to a political level, because of which all that has stopped now. So there is no more such talk taking place anymore. Vijay, my service is 21 years and still time to retire. Should I go in for MPS, NPS for me or my wife? Yes, you should go in for NPS now if you wish to. Otherwise, but please remember that at the age of 60, some amount of that will remain locked in for all your life, right? Are you comfortable with that or not? If not, then please go in for mutual funds instead. If you take good mutual funds, you will get similar benefits as NPS, except that the additional 50,000 rupees worth of tax benefit, which will save you about 10 to 15,000 per year, which is not much, that will not be there. But I feel that, you know, that lock-in after 60 years of age of your corpus is not a good feature at all. So NPS is basically meant for people who will not get pension. You are going to get a pension. Don't lock yourself in. That is my personal view. Sumangla, again, do you think there is any point in waiting to dispose of the property as the property rates may go up, which are 20% less these days? No, ma'am. I do not think so at all. In fact, I gave an example of a flat which of mine. Even though I'm getting lesser, say, like I told you, 1.55 crores, I bought it 6 years back. I am prepared to sell it for 1.5 now, or maybe slightly lower, because if I invest it, even at a stupid 5% interest, I'll make much, much more money than the hope of having the prices of real estate coming up, for which the probability is very low looking at it now. How to decide on term insurance for 20-year PMR? How to decide on term insurance? So is it amount you're talking about? I take it that amount, it is a calculation. There are calculations available. Please get in touch with us. We'll calculate it for you, right? MS Chauhan, kindly enlighten on PMS services being provided by you and how can we make use of it? You will have to contact us separately so that we can explain what are the services that we are providing. We call it the aggressive portfolio because we can't call them PMS. And how does an aggressive work is what we'll explain it to you. Vinayak, thank you very much for sharing your feedback on the link. I will request each one of the participants who are right now to give us the feedback. So I'm wanting to make this retirement seminar a monthly thing so that my seminar can be better next month and more people can benefit from it. Pradeep Ambekar, what is the future of stock market? Say 3 months from now. Nobody knows. Nobody knows 3 months from now. No one can predict, sir. It is very difficult. I don't have the crystal gazing power. Nobody can predict, but I can tell you that in the next 2 months, because of certain global circumstances, stock markets will go up. After 2 months, after 3rd of November, once the presidential elections in US have taken place, then I don't know what will happen to stock markets. What percentage? Okay, that. No other question. Property money is a capital gain on selling, so taxation is to be seen, is what Shell says, definitely. I think due to the time, I may not be able to take more questions. I will just request all the questions that are still balanced. I will request you to please connect with us. We will take on whatever questions are balanced. You can send us the questions on contactus@humphoji.in. We will take them on, please. But it is already 1:10, 1:05. And we are well beyond the time which was promised by us. Thank you very much for attending it. We have started a webinar series. We are going to have webinars which are going to be quite unrelated to even money. Like next Sunday, we have a webinar on security, Indo-China standoff. Four of the most powerful defense analysts are going to take part in it. Please connect with us. Please attend that webinar to learn what is the real thing which is going on behind the scenes. With this, I again thank you for taking time out and attending this webinar. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. I'm closing the webinar now.